In this video, I will solve a challenge posed by math persons on Twitter. The challenge is to convert a number into its binary representation. It is an interesting problem because it is short but challenging. The difficult part is that we must define a function here called what, indicating how many digits the answer is going to have, and then we must prove to the compiler that our implementation of NatVec indeed produces an answer which has that number of digits. I will use Agda, but first let's look at a simpler implementation in Haskell. I'm using an ordinary list, not a vector indexed by its length, and this makes the problem a lot easier. The least significant bit is simply nmod2, and I can compute the rest of the bits by dividing the number by 2 and making a recursive call. Note that the type of the output is not very precise. I know that each element is either going to be 0 or 1, and I have defined a type synonym bit to indicate that this is the case, but the compiler is not enforcing this. I could easily return a list of booleans instead, and that would be more precise, but it would be a bit harder to visually check the answer for correctness. Whereas with 0 and 1, we can see at a glance that the results look correct. Except perhaps for the 0 case, for which I'd rather output a 0 than an empty list, but that's easy to fix, that's not the hard part. Alright, it's that hard part which is interesting, so let's move on to the Agda implementation, which, for now, is also avoiding the hard part, because I'm still outputting a list instead of a vector with a known length. Let's just take a moment to get acquainted with the syntax. Identifiers surrounded by underscores can be used in fix, no need for backticks. And this reversed cons operator inefficiently adds an element to the end of the list, just like in the Haskell implementation. I'm still not using bool for the output type of the elements, for the same reason, to make the output look nice, but this time the type is precise, because fin2 is a type with exactly 2 inhabitants, 0 and 1. fin3 is a finite type with 3 inhabitants, and so on. So, other than this improvement, this implementation is the same as the Haskell implementation, except that it doesn't work. The compiler rejects my implementation because it is not convinced that my implementation of bits will terminate. This requirement is another part which makes writing dependently typed programs much harder. But let's tackle one difficulty at a time. Let's disable the termination checker for now. Now the compiler accepts my program. All right, the hard part. Computing the number of bits which the output will have, and convincing the compiler that our output indeed has this length. The length we want is log base 2, which we can compute by repeatedly dividing the number by 2, and counting the number of times we successfully do so until we reach 0. I can then claim that my output will have size log base 2 of n, but the compiler is not convinced. The error message is not too helpful, but as Connor McBride explains in his Agda course, the question we need to ask ourselves is, where is it stuck? In this case, the compiler is trying to determine whether this expression has the expected type, and it agrees that we're computing a vector of bits, but it thinks our vector has this complicated length, and not log2n as we claimed. Agda thinks that the length is the successor of this complicated expression, because we're appending one element to a complicated recursive expression. This recursive call returns a vector of length log2n, where n is this expression. Apparently div is defined in terms of div helper, and Agda is stuck, it is unable to compute the value which div helper returns, because it doesn't know what n is, and div helper probably pattern matches on this n in order to move forward. That is where Agda is stuck, but it doesn't mean that this is where we need to get Agda unstuck. In fact, suc of log 2 of n divided by 2 is exactly what we want, because suck of log 2 of n divided by 2 is log 2 n, which is what we said we'd return. So why doesn't Agda see that? Well, before Agda can even consider this equation, it needs to be certain that this first equation does not apply. And as far as Agda is concerned, n could very well be 0. Of course, we know it can't, otherwise this other equation would have caught it. We can get Agda to realize this too by pattern matching on the suck constructor. And now that Agda knows that n has the form suck of something, it knows that this second equation is the only one which can apply. So Agda is now happy, we have successfully convinced it that our claim is correct, we are indeed returning a vector of length log 2 of n. Yay! That was the first hard part, let's make it even harder! By turning the termination checker back on. This time, Agda gets stuck earlier. It can't even tell that log 2 of 0 is the same thing as 0, even though that's the first equation. And that's because Agda refuses to attempt to evaluate log 2 of 0, because it is afraid that doing so might not terminate. So let's try to convince Agda that log 2 terminates. Agda doesn't like this recursive call. It looks suspicious because for Agda it is not obvious that n divided by 2 is smaller than n. In fact, the only value which Agda agrees is smaller than n is the number to which n is the successor. But that's not the number we want to recur on, so what can we do? Here is one solution. Let's introduce a limit to the number of recursive calls we can perform. Since the recursive call uses a smaller limit than the one it is given as input, Agda is convinced that limited log 2 will terminate. But are we convinced that it will still give the same answer as log 2? If we were not sure, we could try to write a proof that this is the case, but in this case we are starting with n, which is a relatively high limit, because repeatedly dividing this number by 2 is going to reach 0 much faster than repeatedly decrementing this number by 1. So I am convinced, Agda is convinced, let's move on. Now that Agda thinks that log 2 terminates, it gets stuck a bit further, but this time it doesn't look like we'll be able to get it unstuck, because even if the left hand side was not stuck, it would not evaluate to the right hand side, n divided by 2 is not n, so why does Agda think it should be? Well, the recursive call returns a vector of length log 2 of n divided by 2, to which we append one more element. So Agda computes that we are returning a vector of length suck of log 2 of n divided by 2. But we are claiming to return a vector of length log 2 of n, which is defined as limited log 2 nn. Agda knows that n is a successor, so both those n's are successors, and thus this equation applies. Where this underscore is this limit, which is the predecessor of the first argument. The first argument is n, aka suck of underscore, so those two underscores represent the same number. This other call to log 2, however, uses a different limit. And the difficulty is that those two limits are not the same, and therefore Agda does not know that those two calls to limited log 2 will return the same result. This is the other hard part. The trick is that we have to use the same recursion pattern in bits as we used in log 2. So we limited the number of recursion steps in limited log 2, we have to use the same technique to limit the number of recursion steps for limited bits. Ta-da! Agda is happy. We are again convinced that we will never hit the limit, for the same reason as before, and while we're at it, since we're forced to divide our implementations into a top-level function and a helper, let's take the opportunity to handle the zero special case, for which I want to return a vector of length 1, containing the element 0. This looks like Haskell's syntax for lists, but is in fact a function which produces a singleton vector, and in the same way as the underscores indicate where the arguments go for an infix function, the underscore indicates that the argument to the singleton function goes in between the brackets. This argument consists of the hash function applied to the NAT 0. This function converts the NAT into a fin by making sure at compile time that 0 is one of the two allowed values, namely 0 and 1. All right, we're pretty much done, but I would like to test my implementation. So let's move that to a separate module and start writing a test. As before, I want to look at the numbers from 0 to 9 and convert each of them to their binary representation. And so Agda has this upto function for listing all the numbers from 0 up to, but not including 10. We can use map to apply our bits function to each of those numbers, but it doesn't quite work. Like in Haskell, lists are homogeneous, that is, all their elements must have the same type. But since the output type of bits includes the length of its output, and the results do not all have the same length, they do not all have the same type, and so they cannot all fit in the same list. Instead, we must convert the vector to a list, thereby dropping the information about its length, so that all the elements of the list have the same type, namely list of bit. This compiles, but where's the output? In Agda, tests are executed at compile time. By moving the expression we want to test up to the type level, and asserting that it evaluates to a candidate value. Here, a list of binary representations of the numbers 0 through 9. This is only a type, which may or may not be inhabited. So what makes this a test is that we are claiming that REFL, the reflexivity proof that a value is equal to itself, is indeed an inhabitant of that type. And so the fact that Agda agrees that this expression type checks means that our test has passed. Thanks again to Matt for his challenge, and see you next time, fellow Haskellers!